just in the last year. We took 120 people and we measured their cortisol levels and we measured their immune system response, a chemical called IgA, immunoglobulin A. It's the primary defense against bacteria and viruses. It's better than any flu shot. It's the body's innate mechanism for internal protection. So as cortisol levels go up, as stress hormones go up, and you're tapping the body's resources, immune function goes down. And that's a scientific fact. So we took 117 people and we measured their cortisol levels and IgA levels before they started a 4-day event. And I said, okay, what if we teach them how to create elevated emotions, like gratitude, like joy, like inspiration, and let's measure what happens to their heart to make sure that they're regulating this state properly. Turns out when you're living in fear, when you're living in resentment, when you're living in anger and impatience, the heart beats very incoherently. The mechanism of sustained stress over time causes heart problems. When a person starts to feel more coherent, elevated emotions, the heart starts getting very orderly and very rhythmic, and it sends a very strong signal to the brain, and the person starts to relax, they start to feel safe, they start to change their breathing, they start to expand their energy. Everything changes because the person's falling into the present moment. And they're changing their brainwaves when they do that from the vigilant state of high beta brainwave patterns, when we're obsessing about something and trying to control everything, to beginning to slow their brainwaves down into more of an alpha coherent state. And that imagination creative state is the perfect state to be in when we're executing in our life. We measured their ability to create elevated emotions. And we asked them to sustain those elevated states for 10 minutes a day, 3 times a day, for about 4 days. So my thought was, well, if cortisol levels downregulate the gene to make IgA, which is a protein, and all genes make proteins, what if an elevated emotion could upregulate the gene for IgA and all of a sudden increase the IgA levels? At the end of 4 days, we had a 49.5% increase in immunoglobulin A just by changing our emotional state. So now, let's look at the mechanics of this. If you're living in the same emotional state every single day, as I said earlier, your body is the unconscious mind, is believing it's in some environmental condition because the emotion is the end product of an experience in your environment. Latest research on genes tells us genes don't create disease. It's the environment that signals the gene to create disease. Well, an experience in an environment produces an emotion. So it's the emotion that signals the gene to either upregulate and make a healthy protein or downregulate and shut a protein off. So in a matter of 4 days, people were able to upregulate the gene to increase their immune function just by thought alone. Well, it's fascinating that you can give someone a sugar pill, a saline injection, or perform some false surgery or treatment. And a certain percentage of those people will accept, believe, and surrender to the thought without any analysis that they're getting the real substance or treatment. And they begin to program their autonomic nervous system to make the exact pharmacy of chemicals equal to the substance or treatment they think they're getting. So the fundamental question is it the inert substance, the placebo that's doing the healing, or is it the body's innate capacity to heal by thought alone? Blue pills work better than red pills. If you name a pill that rhymes with something that it could increase its ability for, it'll work better. People will subconsciously associate with it. If you name a drug something that a person can't pronounce, they'll give their power away to the drug and it'll work even better. They'll be intimidated by it. If you charge more for a medication, it will work better. And if the doctor's enthusiastic about it, it'll work even better. That pill, that sugar pill, works because a person's gotten a substance that they've taken that's taken away their pain. It's changed their internal state. The moment they notice a change in their body, they pay attention to what caused it, and they start to condition themselves to rely on that substance. You give the person the pill the next day, you give the person the pill the next day, you give the person the pill the next day, conditioning, conditioning, conditioning. Then you give them a pill that looks just like that pill, and it's nothing more than starch or sugar, and their body begins to produce the same chemistry. So when they get that pill that's an inert substance, if conditioning is based on the past, then expectation is based on the future. They begin to expect the same outcome as the past, and the anticipation of the event causes the body to naturally begin to make its own chemicals. So that pill then is a symbol of possibility.
So many people come to the edge of the known, and the body has to release information. And if you're sitting in a meditation, and your body is just wanting to be in pain, you've conditioned it that way. And if you become conscious of doing that and begin to apply a formula that we'll teach you this weekend, you are training the body back into the present moment. And every time you go a little further, that's a victory. And every time your body wants to get up and quit and give up, and that program's starting to run and you become aware of it, and you bring the body back down into the present moment, and you tell it it's no longer the mind, that you're the mind, now you're executing a will that's greater than the program, and you're training the animal. Are you with me still? And then it gets bucks and kicks, and it gets angry, and it says, listen, why don't you just get agitated? Why don't you just quit? You're not a good meditator. You're a failure. And it's just looking for something. And you become aware that you're doing that, and you settle the body back down of that, out of that aroused emotional state. Would you agree then, if you did that over and over again, you were telling the body that it was no longer the mind, that you were the mind? Yes or no? And you were training the animal. That's a victory. And those victories add up, I swear to you. Sooner or later, the body's going to realize it's no longer the mind, that finally, you are the mind. That you are back on the throne, and it is going to relax into the present moment. And when it does, that heart of yours blows open and you release energy. Your field around your body begins to emanate more light and information. Now, you feel connected to something greater. And I want you to trust the process of going a little further and working with your body and becoming aware of it, because so many people say, I can't focus, I can't meditate. That's the only thought they have to get beyond. That's it. And we'll teach you a formula, and if you just apply the formula, you'll get better at it. Now, some people have meditated for 40 or 50 years or 30 years or 20 years. I respect that. And all I want you to do is just try what we've been able to isolate as a formula and use the same kind of ability that of sitting still and closing your eyes and getting present, and just try something new. Anywhere you can place your attention, I'm going to ask you to place it right there. And where you place your attention is where you place your energy. And I want you to feed that center with your attention. You're going to learn how to breathe life into it and arouse and awaken this center. And once that center begins to open up and your body starts to trust and you relax and that autonomic nervous system begins to cause the heart to beat more orderly, that field around your body begins to expand up to 3 meters wide. Now that field, that energy is information. That frequency is carrying information. And now you begin to interfere with everybody's energy in this room, and those waves start to resonate and synchronize, and the amplitudes start going up. And the higher the wave, the higher the amplitude, the higher the energy in the room. So then, tuning into new potentials, finding the sweet spot of the generous present moment, moving from space-time into time-space, and understanding the science behind it. And I'll stretch you a little bit, and I want you to just repeat it. You're going to get it. You just got to reach for it.